Hachette Audio presents A Letter to the Luminous Deep, The Sunken Archive, Book 1. Written by Sylvie Cathrall. Read by Claire Morgan, Joshua Riley, Justin Avoth, and Kit Griffiths.
Chapter 1. Letter from E. Sidnason to Henry Clell, year 1002. Dear Scholar Clell, instead of reading further, I hope you will return this letter to its envelope, or, better yet, crumple it into an abstract shape that might look quite at home on a coral reef. I become exceedingly anxious around strangers, you see, and I dared only write this note after convincing myself that you would never read it. It is only now, when I can picture you disposing of these pages in some appropriately dramatic fashion, that I may continue my message without succumbing to trepidation. You do not know me at all, Scholar Clell, but after reading your most recent publication, as well as the four preceding it, I feel as though you have become a dear friend. I only wish a human companion ever brought me as much intellectual bliss as your natural history companion does. Surely you receive letters of this nature from eager readers all the time, though. So I will depart from flattery and approach the more pressing subject that inspired me to risk writing to you in the first place. As a scholar of classification, might you assist me from afar with an inquiry of relative import? A few tides ago, I encountered a species unlike any I have ever seen. Lacking a name for such creatures, I dubbed them elongated fish. They cannot be subtle pipefish, as they do not possess needle-like noses, and far surpass the approximate measurements you offered in your appendix. My fish are also decidedly unsubtle. During my observation of the fish, I noted the following additional traits. They are remarkably quick in the water, possibly crepuscular or nocturnal, and territorial to a fault. Allow me to elaborate, if I may. Yesterday, I sat by my window, watching glimmers of sunset from the surface dye the drop-off waters a stately purple. I do this sometimes, when I feel most at odds with my brain, you see, and find it quite effective. I was all alone. My sister Sophie recently departed on the Ridge Expedition, though because you are also a scholar, I assume you know about that expedition all too well. My apologies. And it was then that I witnessed a most unusual scene, starring the elongated fish. Their colouring was a kind of magenta, speckled with silver, but stretched almost transparent, like strands of hair about to break. Most bizarrely, their bulbous green eyes sat flat on the very tops of their heads, rather than protruding in profile. From tip to tail, each measured longer than our house is tall. Oh, my apologies again. I hoped to avoid boring you with biography, but I suppose the preceding paragraph might confuse you, since you do not know where I live. You may have heard of the late, renowned architect, scholar Amiel Sidnason, she who developed the first underwater dwelling, located a few hundred fathoms off coast from your own boundless campus and colloquially called the Deep House. Well, she was my mother, and I colloquially call it home. While I am not a scholar myself, and pray that you will forgive my boldness in writing to someone of your academic prestige, perhaps you have encountered my esteemed sister, scholar Sophie Sidnason, from the School of Observation at Boundless. Oh, I mentioned her just a few sentences ago, did I not? Or my rather less esteemed brother, apprentice scholar Arvist Sidnason. Yes, Our mother defied the typical boundless custom and gave us what she deemed scholarly virtue names, which we all promptly despised and altered. Sophie is short for philosophy, and Arvest, somehow, for artistry. I dare not tell you my given name. Now you understand that I am uniquely privileged when it comes to observing marine life in its natural habitat. I first noticed only one creature, a solitary ribbon, lost in looping sojourns around the window. When she first darted past my window, I felt my heart vibrate. Her eyes rolled around in perfect circles as she executed repeated stalks, perhaps not quite grasping the presence of the glass that disqualified me as potential prey. The sharks who frequent the waters just outside my chamber long since learned to ignore me. Some amount of time later, I found it hard to keep track of the hour. I marveled at the moonbeams illuminating the elongated fish as she continued watching me. After ages of stillness, she flinched, folding and opening like a concertina. I assumed I startled her with my stirring until I spied an even larger creature pulsing its way around the house. As this second elongated fish sped closer, my fish dashed towards the interloper, swirling in a furious helix. They wove around each other, tighter than thread. Tails choked necks and fins found wounds. I watched with rapt horror as they fell into the abyss below the drop-off together. Neither returned. Now, considering your diverse experiences in the field, as it were, I suspect you will not find this encounter especially impressive, and I confess that my elongated fish can hardly compete with the exceptional squid skirmish my family witnessed at the Deep House in year 991. But the novelty of these unfamiliar creatures struck me. I adore how each epilogue of your books invites readers to stop by your laboratory anchorage at Boundless Campus to share news of unusual sightings with you, but circumstances prevent me from coming in person. Still, I would be most grateful if you would consider assessing my account of these creatures from afar. That is, of course, assuming you did not do as I asked by destroying this letter without even reading it. Sincerely, E. Sidnosin. P.S. Allow me to apologize for the rudimentary sketch of the elongated fish that I enclosed. Please attribute any unforgivable errors to my non-existent professional training. A sketch of an elongated fish. The body is eel-shaped, ribboned and with pleated fins extending out from either side of the body from head to tail. There are no visible arms or legs.
Letter from Sophie Sidnorje to Viring Clell, Year 1003. Dear Captain Clell, forgive this unexpected intrusion from your former acquaintance through grief, otherwise known as me, Sophie Sidnosin. Well, Sidnorje now, technically. As my wife and I are newlywed, we combined our family names in accordance with Boundless Campus custom. If it helps, I also go by E's sister. When you and I met for the first and final time, just after Henry and E's disappearance, I promised to keep in touch, in that vague, non-committal way that one so often does. Well, I come at last, a year later, to make that promise less empty. I do not wish to resurrect painful memories for you. Rather, I hope that the contents of this package will provide some comfort. After I lost E, I tasked myself with putting my sister's belongings in order as a distraction. Even after the Deep House's destruction, E's safe box, a funny waterproof little thing designed by our mother, survived intact, tucked into a crack in the coral bed. When the salvagers presented me with the safe box, just days after the explosion, I wasted no time, nor spared any expense, in hiring a locksmith to open it. I expected to find the box stuffed with drawings, rare books, curious shells, and perhaps a family photograph or two. Imagine my surprise when I discovered that my excessively introverted sister kept a cache of countless letters.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.